I see you. I see you. And seeing the tears welling up from your soul, birth tears in my eyes. I see you and I feel your pain. I see you, those who are watching. I see you fighting to be seen, to not be erased, to be given what you deserve. And now we can continue to fight for the same in one another. So let us enter into this time of worship. With friends and strangers, with family and neighbors, we gather. Come among us, healing God. Come with us that love, with love that will never end, with faith that reaches out to touch, with hearts that are straining to trust, we hope. Come among us, friends of the broken, with your compassion which makes us whole, with words and wonder, with silence and song, while we wait. Come among us, dryer of tears, to lift us to our feet, to follow you, our Lord and Savior. Let us pray. Merciful and loving God, we are slow to see the blood around our feet. We get so self-absorbed that we deny our own power to act and to be of service. We forget that we are made whole by a wounded healer. Forgive us, we pray. Free us to use power rightly and to serve you joyfully. Free us from fears that paralyze us. Aimlessness that plague our visions. Heal us, O Lord.
Amen.
Of unconditional redemptive love and forgiveness. So I pose to you a few probable reasons. First, that it is a natural born inclination. We are endowed as God's creation to cry out for mercy, but we carry the unbearable burden of sin upon our shoulders. It is an innate primal instinct to cry out from the depths of despair for release or relief from pain. In David's case, his life had embodied perpetual sin. In fact, he is often considered to be a tragic historical figure in Jewish tradition. It is noted by scholars that his relationship with Bathsheba and the loss of their son are considered central in a vast array of tragedies that entered into his life. And I don't believe if David was around today, he would deny this fact. As a writer of most of our Psalms, he always seemed to stay in a state of seeking spiritual asylum from his provocative life. Psalm 51 helps us understand the heart of David and also to understand his allegiance with God. For after he so grievously sinned against God and all of his family, hear him as he pleads with God. Generous in love, God, give grace. Huge in mercy, wipe out my bad record. Scrub away my guilt. Soak out my sins in your laundry. I know how bad I've been. My sins are staring me down. You're the one I violated. You've seen it all, seen the full extent of my evil. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. I've been out of step with you for a long time. In the wrong since before I was even born. What you're after is truth from the inside out. Enter me then. Conceive a new true life. Soak me up in your laundry and I will come out clean.
Amen.
Scrub me and I'll have a snow white life. Tune me in to foot tapping songs. Set those once broken bones to dancing. Don't look too close for blemishes. Give me a clean bill of health. God, make a fresh start in me. Shake a Genesis week from the chaos of my life. Don't throw me out with the trash or fail to breathe holiness in me. Bring me back from my great exile. Put a fresh wind in my sails. And of course, it continues on. Sling and a Stone shares that David's intense grieving and suffering, the one that was over his sin and the death of his son, is actually a moving passage. David writes the 51st Psalm, though he has been assured that his sin has been pardoned. He always prays earnestly for God's legal reprieve, and he greatly laments his sin. He was willing to bear the shame of his sins and had it go before him. David submitted to the will of God in the death of one child, and God actually made up for the loss to his advantage in the birth of another. The way we see our peace and comfort return back to us is tough in some situations, or the restoration of life through loss is made up in some other way that we did not even imagine. So we should be cheerfully willing to resign all of ourselves to God. Cheerfully resign every part of ourselves to God. For by his grace, God not only ordered David's newborn son to be called Jedediah, beloved of the Lord, but he never withdrew his favor from David, as he had done with Saul and with others. Perhaps it was because God has a habit of being able to work with those who are genuinely convicted in heart and spirit and who love him in kind. And yet secondly, combined with our natural inclination is included an incurable belief that forgiveness is a certainty. Forgiveness is a certainty. You see, David never poured out his heart to God without believing forgiveness was at the end of the rainbow. In spirit, he was reassured to some degree to never give up hope, to hang in there beyond what he felt he could humanly do. Amen. He knew where his limitations ended and God's limitlessness began. He knew where his limitations ended and where God's ability to take over and do what God does best began.
Alright.
And so should we. For we are limited, but God is limitless. In his book, The Soul of Politics, Jim Wallace says, hope believed is always considered nonsense. But hope believed is history and the process of being changed. And even in biblical instances where David slays Goliath, Israel was never the same. You see, David exemplified that we are all capable of being bigger than our fears. That size doesn't matter. That we must be resourceful and make use of what we already have. It's a sling and a rock. To believe it is possible and to not underestimate our capabilities. How many times in our television moments have we failed to be the church that God calls us to be? Well, the opposite of the attributes David holds dear. How many times have we ceased to be bold and exceptional examples of the gospel for the world to see and embrace? Have we been available for those who are in need around us? The ones who see mercy and grace most actively. Have we shied away from reaching the unreachable? Have we invited God into the spirit-filled realm of evangelism and missional work? What prompts us to settle in and lock the doors with normalcy? Even still, thirdly, David was never in a rush. Never in a rush to receive the peace of God. The peace of God that passes all understanding. David learned one of the hardest lessons we'll ever learn in life. To wait in the midst of pain. In Psalm 121, we hear David share, I will lift up mine eyes to the hills. From whence cometh my help? For my help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer my foot to be moved. Hope. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Hope. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. For the Lord is my keeper. The Lord is the shade upon thy right hand. And in verse 5 of today's text, he says, I wait for the Lord. My soul doth wait. David's faith in God propelled him to believe that nothing would ever separate him from the love of God.
Amen.
That there was absolutely no obstacle or barrier to his faith that could prevent him from believing that the God of his ancestors, who had freed his forefathers and foremothers from the bondage of slavery, was indeed capable of doing the same with his sin-filled state. David's life capitulated what Paul shares in Philippians 4:12. And this says that I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. You see, David had learned through his faith that when you have nothing to gain and everything to lose, there is a peace in the midst of waiting. Because in that quiet anticipation, we know that when God is in it, the wait is all the more worthwhile. Because the outcome will be far beyond our wildest dreams. Charles Wesley's lyrics affirmed this truth when he coined the words, "Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set the people free. From our fears and sins, release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art. Dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Are you still so burdened with sin that you believe you are not worthy of forgiveness? May God release you from that self-inflicted limitation that keeps you from entering into full fellowship with the Savior. For he loves you, he accepts you as you are. Broken in spirit, contrite in heart, or as Robert Robinson shared in the old familiar hymn, "Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Sorry I shall be in spirit, till released from flesh and sin. Yet from what I do inherit, here thy praise I will begin." In the midst of your personal storms,
yes,
know that God is at the end of it all, and that he simply wants you to trust him for the outcome. Let him move in your life. Don't be afraid to be waiting. Allow your natural inclination to believe that there is a God of mercy and grace. Walk in the power of the Holy Spirit that affirms and reaffirms on a daily basis that you are his and he is yours. And he loves you unconditionally. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
Give us the strength, health, wisdom, and knowledge found only. have received and experienced a respite today from the storms of care and concern. That if you feel that you are in a sinful state, know that you have a God that loves you unconditionally, and that His mercy and His grace endures forever. Continue to give to Metropolitan through the various needs that are available online, dropping it off in the mailbox outside the church, or in person as you exit the sanctuary. Well, let us now prepare to receive the benediction. God wants us to go out among the outcasts and the weary. God wants us to speak words of life and hope. God wants us not to be afraid, but to trust God and His words. To watch for the Lord with eager anticipation, expectation. To be generous with all that God has given us. And God will respond to our every cry with mercy. And so may Christ take us by the hand and lift us up in this life. And may the Holy Spirit build us up in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in passion, in love, and in action. We go in peace to serve the Lord. Remove obstacles out of our ways, O Lord, and let us rejoice in knowledge, patience, kindness, purity, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. Go in peace until we meet again. In the name of Christ, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.